Merseyside between April and March 2020 to 2021. Then that increased to 833 in the most recent financial year, and then so far 194 in the most recent. The highest proportion of those detentions are taken to the Royal, followed by equal measures into Aintree and Iron Park.
Do you know why there's been an important increase in Section 136s?
Yeah, I think what we're probably seeing now is a resumption of sort of the norm, if you like. Obviously, the previous year, impact of lockdown, COVID, etc. Clearly, there was some challenges around availability of mental health services in that period, and obviously we're also facing a number of societal challenges now, like cost of living, etc, etc. So I think it would be reasonable to expect an increase in mental health episodes and the prevalence within society.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
And then in terms of the impact then on, again, similar to the constant observations in terms of time taken and the intervals, what do you think, what impact does that have on the force?
Well, it will have clearly a significant impact on the availability of operational officers, because once they detain them, 136 to take them to place of safety, we've only got that time delay built into it, and get 3 times on over. What I would say, highlight, obviously Louise has articulated pointed out some of the wait times, but if you look at the, and we'll come on to the Prometheus pilot perhaps in a second, but if you look at the Arrow Park and Royal, which are the two places where the pilot's in place, mm-hmm. you will see over the last 3 months a gradual decrease in the wait time. So Arrow Park, February 2022, 13 hours and 17, and you can see some good reductions in time, quite lots of time there. And likewise at the Royal again, that are consistent from January 22 until April 22, a gradual reduction in time. So that would, I think, is some good evidence to say the pilot is effective and working in those particular locations.
Commissioner, you asked the average time to reach the mental health bed. We don't have that information. It's not a requirement of the detention of 136. We do think that some of the mental health trusts will have that information. Next on this one is around the availability of mental health beds and how the force is working in partnership to tackle the issue. So the National Crisis for Bed Management, as you know, Merseyside Police are working collaboratively with Mental Health and Acute Hospital Trust to ensure policy and practice that is in place is adhered to, most importantly, good communication between police and the trust to ensure the bed is identified. The earliest opportunity. This just gives the Prometheus data for the most recent 5 weeks. Week one, so the amount of hours present, 63.5, officer time saved, 127, with a cost saving of $2,286. That raised to 250.5 with an increase in the cost saving of £4,500. Slight dip in week three, but that obviously reflects that amount of hours that were present, and then that for over £3,000, and week 5 over £1,000 there. So it has a total just over £12,000 cost saving during the pilot. The individual issues are raised on a case-by-case basis by the command team and the crisis care concordat. Prometheus now used as a pilot to reduce police manpower about due to the national bed crisis, with suitable risk assessed by the police inspector, their staff take over the observation of the patient in the hospital whilst they wait for that assessment, and that obviously then frees up police resources that are urgently needed elsewhere. The risk to this is that the pilot is only for 6 months. Mm-hmm. So even with that in place, the section 136 detentions are expiring beyond 24 hours due to that bed crisis, and the support to manage the risk, the bed escalation policy, both within custody and the community health-based settings, has been implemented. The process has been agreed with Prometheus to, in the event that the power does expire, and the person may need to be subject to a further assessment by police officers to ensure they are safeguarded where risks are present in the process starting.
So in terms of the funding for this Prometheus pilot then, does the funding for that outweigh, or is that less than the savings that you've identified in terms of the investment is worth the savings that you're making, if that makes sense?
The investment at this stage would be as well worth the investment, and that's only a 5-week period of some indicative savings. We're 4 months into a 6-month pilot, and there isn't any money ring-fence at this point to continue close to 6 months, so there is conversation ongoing between ourselves, NHS England, the local authority and the three mental health trusts that are impacted. We are hopeful of being able to identify further funds. There's also an option if we can't find the funds around sort of slimming down the model at the moment as three or one nurse and two mental health assistants in each Prometheus team. There's a possibility to sort of review that and perhaps make some savings around that. But those are the conversations that are ongoing.
We'll keep your data on this one, Commissioner. Remaining if you continue to support around it, because there's a financial element to it. There is having officers in the right place,
yeah.
But it's also having the right care for the person who needs it, which isn't an officer ongoing within that mental health crisis that's taking place. And there's some fantastic work in the Wallasey team, Marvin, in particular, around this. There are some other areas that we want to go in relation to where policing is stepping into space, which we are happy to do because we have that role to protect the most vulnerable as well, but it's where we then end up staying in that space where another professional is the best place a person can see that programme in the city centre, etc. We're dealing with people like injured as well. So this is a really good piece of work. We will want to elongate it, we will want this to be permanent as well. We are ongoing with those financial discussions. I think we all agree that policing should be the one to actually remain with that person at hospital, and nor should we want to funding it as well. But we're grateful for the work of our partners in supporting this, and those conversations are very much ongoing as well.
No, that's really positive, and I think I would agree. It's not even just about police resources, it's about, as you say, right person, right care, is what you talk about, isn't it? And I think that's important. So certainly if there's anything that I can do, particularly in terms of a national level, please do let me know.
Yeah, I was going to say, Commissioner, I think it's one in terms of obviously, you know, the policing minister talks often around the impact of mental health and police picking up the pieces, and I think it would be one to raise with APCC. I'm not sure which Commissioner leads on that, into the Commissioner, policing minister.
Yeah, I'm the joint lead for internal custody, so I can pick up with my colleagues on it.
Okay. Commissioner, you asked about suicide risk and the wait times for response and treatment pathway. We don't have that recorded. It would be more than recorded by health in their AA wait times statistics. But in respect of negating suicide risk and the response treatment pathway, street triage assist us. Ordinarily, officers dealing with incidents of mental health at home would have limited options to options available, and one of the main ones would be that attendance at A&E voluntarily and being left there to remain and wait for support. triage car would often attend immediately, either alongside the patrol officers, with the individual, or remain at the scene to assess the individual and negate or reduce their suicide risk whilst the patrol are dealing with the incident. Due to the triage car's involvement, we do find that there are other avenues of support for those individuals that can be implemented. They do have a significant access to additional resources, patient boards and support pathways to reduce and negate risk, and then identify those appropriate pathways of support. There are many following assessment by the Ducie Street triage practitioner. The range of outcomes for that individual will be something like no further action or role for mental health services, referral to secondary mental health services, referral and signposting to a partner or third sector organisations with additional support, hospitalisation, informing of the individual has the capacity to consent, or a referral for the Mental Health Act assessment. If they require formal attention under the Mental Health Act. During the incident when street triage has involvement, there's no requirement for patrol officers to complete all the personal forms for referrals because of that triage by the triage car, which is relevant.
So in terms of when we talk about suicide risk, in terms of the data that the force holds then, if somebody responds to an incident where, if for example there's somebody on a bridge who's looking to take their life, would we record that as a suicide attempt, or is it a broader category around mental health? Is that the challenge in terms of that recording? Do you know? Sorry, I'm not too careful.
I wouldn't want to give you the answer on that one. Okay. I'll come back to you in terms of how exactly that's recorded. Probably because of a combination of both, but I'll confirm that.
Because part of the reason for asking this, I have spoken to the chief before about it, is this linked with suicide and domestic abuse, and how will we create the links around abuse and the implications for that, and just in terms of how well we record the data around suicide risk. It'd be interesting to have a look at. I think we'll have a bit more time.
Yeah, we do monitor what we know about basically.
Right.
There's lots of work in course team. We know, for example, there's been 8 suicide incidents linked to domestic abuse.
Right.
Over the 1st of April to the 31st of October last year. A lot of work going on with Mark Wiggins, making sure that we look and review all of those. And we're working with Mark and the team to just see where we can put some of our analysis resources around that to see what we can find out.
Thanks. The other work around that is each one of those tragic circumstances also robustly investigated,
yeah,
one by ourselves to determine whether it's a crime, but also the coroner in terms of what's been to work through the criminal process as well. Also, there are a number of those instances that will feature within domestic homicide reviews as well, in order to take the learning from them across the whole partnership, obviously not just where they've been policing interventions as well. So we do absolutely recognise the tragic nature of that, that the level of investigation, the robustness of investigation through the head of crime and then through the partnership process as well.
This one gives you an overview of the triage cars, the numerous times that we've used them, explanation and how we work in partnership. So we have the number of locks which the triage car is called to on the left hand side.
Sorry, can you just explain what the triage car is so we know what we're...
Thank you, Commissioner. So triage car on duty 7 days a week from 8 in the morning to 11 at night. That is consists of a police officer and a mental health practitioner working together, and they are able to respond to incidents of mental health, whether that be that they can update a log in terms of providing advice, they can make contacts on the phone, or they can actually attend in person and deal accordingly. There is one for each of the mental health trusts, so one in the rural, one for combined with the public sector.
of the 8,474 logs, 2,732 visits. They'll also conduct work over the phone, so that's 5,305 occasions. And then, most importantly, the number of sexual abuse cases that are prevented by the attendance of the triage car is at 659 over the last 14 months. On average, each 136 detention lasts 8 hours with two officers attended.
Mm-hmm.
At the average rate of £18 per hour, it's spared over 10,500 policing hours and a cost saving to the force of 189,792. So very much demonstrating our reactive, but proactive and preventative work there.
Am I right thinking as well as an impact on demanding to the contact centre because you're identifying people who maybe wouldn't call repeatedly?
Absolutely. It's part of the preventative approach, problem solving, identifying those sort of repeat callers, repeat patients, I guess. Huge demand reduction capability there. You know, and certainly when you sort of lay that out and we look at the previous slide in terms of the hours at the place of safety, you know, the average there, crossing 8 hours, but it's true, probably longer than that. Huge savings that are being realised by this. But the bottom line is the patients are getting better care, getting better advice, better care, better supports, and better referral on the ongoing pathways. So I think it's certainly a real positive for the whole sort of collaboration, I guess, around dealing with mental health. And what I would also just want to mention, the team have actually won the North West Regional NHS Parliamentary Award by the Merseyside Foundation for, quote, excellence in urgent emergency care award, so regional North West, and then on to the national final. So I think that's some recognition for some of the great work that they are doing.
The mental health training for officers and staff is comprehensive. Police officers receive a full Monday input around mental health as per their objectives within John Moores University. They also receive a one-day input from the academy in relation to powers, signs and symptoms and the triage car itself. For our PCSOs in their initial training, they receive training on mental health as part of the wider vulnerability module that they have. For those officers that work within triage, they receive bespoke, more in-depth training around Mental Health Act legislation and associated processes with the regular CPD, including use of partner agencies within them. They're also prepared for experienced triage officers before carrying out the role alone. The new contact resolution officers receive input on mental health and suicide, including the signs of both the signs of mental health stress and knowledge of sexual abuse powers. The dispatchers also receive similar training, particularly as well in addition to the triage car and that use of the deployment of that car. The custody staff receive half day input from the Merseyside Criminal Justice Mental Health Liaison Team, delivered by the Criminal Justice Mental Health Learning and Development Regional Manager from Merseycare, and any updates and changes or legislation or process for existing custody staff is delivered by the Trust on the CPD there.
So in terms of the training that they... Oh, sorry, so we have a bit on training. Sorry, George, you'd like to join us on
that. Okay, so the mental health first aid trainers run through our occupational health unit, and that will continue to be funded through the academy. We have an e-learning package, Mental Health and the Police, which is live on College Learning. The academy has a course training and evaluation officer who's reviewed all mental health training, and along with Hayley Sherwin, making sure that it's kept up to date. Bespoke training is provided for the force duty officers and those in the bronze role within response and resolution about those specific powers, roles and responsibilities they have. And then last but not least, 25 mental health spots within response and resolution and local police have undergone specific high level training, including inputs from partner agencies on legislation and policy. That takes place over a 2-day initial course.
So when we talk about mental health then, does that cover the broader range of training around things like learning disabilities, autism, you know, anyone on the spectrum? It, it kind of looks at the different ways that people work, because it's quite a broad terminology, mental health, isn't it?
It is, and it does cover all those elements that you just highlighted. I mean, I think clearly, you know, the officers and staff that have identified here, it's not just mental health, you know, there's a whole spectrum of training that requires to do so, but this does take a significant proportion of their time in terms of the CPD, and I think it's absolutely, you know, it's absolutely merited in terms of, if you look at the amount of demand that it's across the organisation, it's entirely right that the training is like that.
And so when you say CPD, it's obviously ongoing, so they don't get it on the first week and then don't talk about it again. There's obviously numerous points throughout the journey.
Absolutely, yeah. And we've Hayley Sherwin, who made our mental health lead. I mean, she's not just a force, she's a national expert, and what she can add to sort of the training and the ongoing CPD is fundamental to what we do. So we're very, you know, grateful to have her.
Okay, great, thank you for that. So I think we're moving on now to finance, is that right? So thank you, Hannah, for always very patiently.
Okay, yes, I'm just going to provide an update on the forecast out to position for 2021-22. There will be more detail later this month as part of the outturn report.
Okay.
So this is just a higher level forecast. So the first slide shows the position against the revenue budget with an overall underspend of 8.1 million. Now this represents around 2.2% of our revenue budget, of 370 million. Of this 8.1, approximately half relates to ongoing operations, 4.1 million, and with additional underspend from the North West Roku and from our uplift budget.
Right.
So this is just representative of the sound financial management throughout the year and review of expenditure. So, next slide. The second slide just shows the forecast position in relation to the capital budget. So, total forecast expenditure is 22.2 million against a budget of 41.8 and underspend of 19.6. Now, if you look at the right hand column, you can see that the majority of this underspend relates to work on the estate. Now this was impacted by supply chain issues post-COVID and stop news in the national press. Similarly, for the vehicle replacement programme, there is supply chain issues on new vehicles. So there will be a request as part of that outturn report to rephase a large part of this capital expenditure into 2022-23 so we can catch up with the vehicle replacement programme.
So in terms of the underspend then, what's the plan in terms of spending it?
We're already leasing that for the MGMS period to
data from say the crime scene, any vigilant and wellness, public health, for example. There are a number of underdeveloped national crime and policing outcome measures. So for the purposes of this presentation, we are not able to show any measures around the tackling cybercrime, because that's very much around the cyber way tracker. But we've given you exactly what we can get from police data to sort of make sure.
Can I just check, is the data rolling or is it a fixed period? So when we go on to the first line around homicide, when it's 21 to 22, is that equal to April, so it's a set?
Yes, yeah, so we have what we call a digital crime policing pack that's published nationally.
Yes.
And within that pack, it gives you all different ways to carve your data effectively.
Right.
But it comes in every 3 months, I think. And it's also about 3 to 6 months behind.
Yeah.
So what we've done with this is, because we know that the measure of homicide is police reported crime anyway, we've used our data to give you most recent up-to-date figures. That will goes through the Home Office data hub anyway, so that it will be reflected within the digital pack.
I think the reason I'm asking is just so, because we look at this quarterly, it's how do I know, I suppose the question is what's changed in the last quarter? That's the bit we want to know in terms of how to be monitoring. But they're fine.
So I can cover a little bit of that in the update.
Okay.
For the latest 12-month period, when you look at the PAC, which also has homicide index data and police recorded data, so it's a mixture of two. The police recorded data is what we record, the homicide index data is after those cases have been reviewed.
Right.
So just slight differences in there. Across England and Wales, there's been an overall reduction of 9% for homicide, falling from 617 to 621. Of the seven most similar group areas that we have, there's a total of 177 homicides within the last 12 months and 162 compared to the year before, so that 9% increase in some of the most similar groups.
Yeah.
So mixed bag really. What we've tried to do is demonstrate the homicides for Merseyside between the years 2014 and 15, and then through into 2021-22 financial year. And then what we've done is we've split that between domestic and non-domestic. And those firearms, homicides that might have an element where a firearm might have been used or a knife may have been used. So for the most recent year, 5 domestic related homicides. Our biggest category is the non-domestic related homicides at 12. And this isn't like additional, these are within that 15. Two of those has a firearm element and 8 of those has a knife element. The graph on the right shows one of the critical success factors, and we put this in because this is very much around that operational interface funding, and that's about having a reduction in all non-domestic abuse related homicides, and especially of victims aged up to 25 involving knives. That's been on a decreasing trend over the last 8 years. This financial year to date, we've had 17 financial year to date, 2 of those are knife enabled under 25. Some of those are going through reclassification as well. So we are doing a lot of work around debriefing, analysing. We have an ongoing problem profile around homicide, and all of that sort of mailing is taken in through the analysis and pushed through the prevention strategies that we have.
Getting back to the presentation about the beginning as well, on a national level, a local level, led by Chris, working with John and Andy and the team. One, we are reviewing all homicides immediately, so there'll be immediate debrief, so obviously some will feature as part of reviews, statute reviews, serious case reviews, or domestic homicide reviews through community safety partnerships, but we'll have a rapid review for our homicides to see if there's any immediate prevention, so a case study.
Okay.
Then I see there's any immediate learning, again, that can feed back into
discharge of the qualified alarm and police recorded data. On here, what we've shown you is the national measures for recorded knife crime and TIG data. So those are the critical success factor one, which is that reduction in hospital admissions for a knife and those victims under 25. We use the trauma intervention intelligence group data to give us the insights around this. Up to February 2022, when you compare to the same period in 2019, we have seen a 66% reduction from 44 down to 15 of those who are under 25 being admitted to hospital for sharp object injury. So absolute significant reductions in those volumes. For the critical success factor two, which is about a reduction in knife-enabled serious violence, and especially amongst victim aged under 25. The red line on the graph relates to the knife crime victims under 25. This financial year to date, you can see a 2.5% reduction when compared to last year. Needle spikings are excluded from the data, and when we take those needle spikings out, the actual reduction in knife crime victims is 14%. When we then see what we are seeing is a shift into the a slight increase in victims who are aged 25 and over, so 5.7% increase in knife crime when you compare to last year. But then when you again take out those needle spikings, that's 1.9%. So from a statistics point of view, fairly stable. The second part of that reducing serious violence outcome is offences involving the discharge of a firearm. This includes information up till the end of 2022, the financial year 22. And when we compare to the same period, 12-month period for the previous year, about a 12% reduction a downward trend, and when we then try to forecast, we do think that we'll see further reductions in this financial year. The next one is robbery. This one, we've seen a relatively stable, slight decrease in the volume. It is on a downward trend, and again, we do forecast some reductions in robbery. Just this category does include both personal and business robbery.
Okay.
The third one is vehicle crime. This includes impairments with the vehicle. There's been a reduction of 21% year end with regards to this crime. That's 1,891 less victims. And again, based upon that, those reductions, we are forecasting some increases in vehicle crime. Having said that, we haven't seen that play out so far. We are currently in June of the new financial year, and that's not starting to play out at the moment within our statistics.
Do we know what the little spike is due to in March?
I've done some work on it, but I'll have to come back to you.
Okay, sure.
If that's okay.
Yeah.
And then the last one here, the next is theft in person. Mm-hmm. So this is financial year to date, we saw a small reduction of 3.4%, but 83 less victims. And again, we are starting to look forecast tell us it might increase. We are seeing some areas where we are seeing changes in theft in person, particularly within the city. There's operation around that, but we are absolutely analysing this victim offender location and seeing where there's any vulnerabilities. And then,
Commissioner, sorry, each one of those areas subject to obviously daily review around farmers. Myself or local locations around this, you've got around the ground, slight increase in central and rural,
yeah.
To town around the crime. And again, we'll look at the work across the board, whether it's prevention work, typically with BioM, around to pursue based activity around those grounds for committing crime. So, as you've seen from the reads there, it's pretty, you know, as we saw some reductions during COVID, slight increases.
And then the final slide on the SIO is satisfaction with police amongst victims of domestic abuse. For the purposes of today, we've shown both the overall satisfaction and then those of the domestic abuse. When we then look at the two periods that we've shown over the last financial years, we have an overall satisfaction rate of 89-90% for all outcomes of crime. And then we'll look at cases of domestic abuse, and then that resulted in outcome 16, and that's where people decline to follow a prosecution. There's been a slight reduction in overall satisfaction from 86-84% between the two periods. So that's monitored on a daily basis by my team. Mm-hmm. We will read all of the verbatim